Before proceeding, please make sure to subscribe and turn on the bell icon for upcoming videos. Hello, and today's video is about Sialolithiasis. Sial refers to salivary gland, and lith refers to a stone. The suffix iasis means formation. So, in definition, sialolithiasis are calcified structures that forms within the salivary gland or its ducts. The exact mechanism of a sialolith is not clear, but researches done up to date suggest that they may arise from a nidus or debris retained within the ductal lumen, making its lumen partially blocked. This nidus or debris is composed mainly of mucus, bacteria, ductal epithelial cells, and foreign bodies. The nidus provides a really good environment for the deposition or attachment of salivary minerals, which are mostly the calcium salts. These salts are laid down in laminations, resulting in the formation of a stone or a sialolith. The major composition of a sialolith is calcium phosphate, which accounts for 75%, calcium carbonates for 12%, soluble salts and organic matter for 5%, and 3% of water. Coming to some clinical features of sialolithiasis, sialolithiasis affects mostly middle-aged individuals with a slight male predilection. In about 70 to 90% of cases, the stones most often are formed within the ductal system of the submandibular gland. And less often, the stones may form within the parotid and sublingual glands. The stones could also form within the minor salivary glands, most often within the glands of the upper lip and the buccal mucosa. The reason why these stones or sialoliths are formed most frequently in the submandibular gland than any of the other glands are followings. Multiple sharp bends in the submandibular or Wharton's duct, more viscous nature of saliva of this gland compared to other major glands, the higher calcium levels in saliva of this gland, and the dependent position of the gland, which often increases the chance of stasis of saliva in the submandibular duct. In case of symptoms, patients experience episodic pain, especially during meal times, because there is a sudden increase in saliva secretions when taste and smell of a food is experienced. The severity of symptoms is directly proportional to the degree of obstruction of the duct and resultant back pressure produced within the gland resulting from the obstruction. That is, if the duct is completely obstructed by a sialolith, the saliva produced within these glands cannot move beyond the obstructed zone, hence moves backwards, resulting in high back pressure and extreme pain. Bacterial infection can occur when the gland is filled with stagnant saliva, resulting from backflow of saliva with signs of fever, foul taste in the mouth, and redness over the affected area. If the stone is located towards the terminal portion of the duct, then a hard mass may be palpated beneath the mucosa, just seen in this picture. On gross examination, the stone may be round, oval, or cylindrical in shape. They may be yellow to white to yellow-brown in color. The stones may range from tiny particles to stones that are several centimeters in size. The stones are usually solitary, but there might be multiple stones present in a single region. Microscopically, the stones are acellular and amorphous or shapeless. The ductal lining which surrounds the stone often demonstrates metaplastic changes. Radiographically, the stones appear as radio-opaque masses, but still, their radio-opacity will be based on their degree of calcification, And that's the reason that not all salivary stones are visible on a radiograph, the reason behind being the low degree of calcification. Stones in the terminal portion of the duct or near its orifice are best diagnosed with an occlusal radiograph. Other non-imaging studies are sialography, ultrasound, and computed tomography in some complex cases. Diagnostic sialendoscopy is the gold standard procedure for diagnosis and treatment of salivary gland diseases. In this technique, a small endoscope is inserted within the ductal orifice, allowing visualization of the entire ductal system for any stones, strictures, or adhesions. Coming to the treatment now, the treatment options are based on the size of a sialolith. Small sialoliths can be treated in a conservative way, such as a gentle massage of the gland in an effort to melt the stone towards the ductal orifice. Drugs that induce saliva, called sialagogues, can also be used. Moist heat and an increase in fluid intake may also promote passage of the stone. In case of larger stones, the only option we have is their surgical removal. If you think this video was really helpful, please do like the video and hit the subscribe button. Besides, if you have got any questions or suggestions regarding this video, you may write them down in the comment box. Thank you for watching.